cornucopia, the horn of plenty, has long been the symbol of abundant supplies. Today, the Navy's horn of plenty is a golden embroidered oak leaf embellished with three small acorns, the symbol of ample supply for the Navy's officers and men, for its ships and establishments in all parts of the world. Look for the officers who wear the oak leaf insignia, and you'll find the men of the Supply Corps, the business experts of the United States Navy. Under the Bureau of Supplies and Accounts, the men of the Corps transact the business of a huge and many-sided organization, feeding the Navy's men at sea and on shore, clothing them under all conditions of climate and duty, paying them promptly in any part of the world, providing personal services through Navy exchange facilities and ship stores, getting the Navy what it needs, where it needs it, when it needs it. This is the vital work of the Supply Corps. But there was a time in the early days of our country when this Corps did not exist, for there was then no Navy. Our merchant ships went out to sea unprotected by naval vessels, until attacks on them by the Barbary pirates roused Congress to action. Here was the birth of our Navy, the construction of six frigates, authorized by the Naval Armament Act of 1794. From the very beginning, these ships were directed to carry a purser of warrant officer rank. Important among his responsibilities was to keep an accurate account of the crewmen's wages, paying them not with money, but with certificates countersigned by the captain. The purser met the victualling requirements of his ship and sold the crew articles of clothing known as slops. These were the fundamentals of supply. And the purser was the man assigned to supply, the man who was to become today's Supply Corps officer. Almost a year after the passage of the Armament Act, the Bureau of Supplies and Accounts had its beginning when the Continental Congress passed the Act of February 23, 1795, setting up a purveyor of public supplies. Procurement of supplies for the Navy was one of the main jobs of the purveyor. All this while, trouble on the seas continued to mount, and in 1797, the Secretary of State reported that French ships had seized 32 American merchant vessels. These seizures spurred the establishment of a separate Navy department on April 30, 1798. That same year, the position of accountant was set up under the Secretary of the Navy to account for all money advanced and for stores issued and distributed. Together, the accountant of the Navy and the purveyor of public supplies formed the basic team to provide for naval supply ashore. The young Navy department was rapidly girding itself to cope with French restrictions on American trade, planning, preparing for counterblows. The military needs of the day were for vessels and more vessels, and appropriations rose steadily to finance the program. In 3 years, from 1796 to 1799, naval force appropriations rose from a few thousand dollars a year to almost $3 million. In this period of swift expansion, the famous Constitution and Constellation, along with some 60 other ships, were built or purchased. But as the fleet multiplied, so did the problems of supply. Many supply functions ashore were now administered by civilian Navy agents, appointed by the Secretary of the Navy. The plans and preparations were soon paying off in successful engagements with French vessels. Most famous of these was the defeat of the French frigate Insurgent by the USS Constellation. The science of supply took a big leap forward in 1804 during the war with Tripoli, when the ketch Intrepid transferred a cargo of fresh provisions to the squadron under Commodore Edward Preble. Here in its early form was replenishment at sea, the forerunner of a vital phase of naval logistics which today is commonplace, supplying the fleet at sea, on the move, in action. Through this new technique, the American squadron was able to remain at sea and enforce a continental blockade of the port of Tripoli. During this time, pursers usually came directly from civilian life, since their jobs demanded that they have a thorough knowledge of banking, accounting, and commercial subjects. Also required was a knowledge of French and Spanish to transact business in foreign ports. But the purser who was a businessman on the shore quickly became a fighter at his battle station aboard ship during active combat. When the War of 1812 broke out, the office of Purveyor of Public Supplies was abolished, and his duties shifted to the Secretary of the Navy. As the fleet grew, Congress created a board of Navy commissioners to procure all naval materials and stores. Then, in 1818, Navy regulations established the purser of the yard at naval shipyards, for the first time entitling the purser to shore duty. He fed and paid all the officers and men attached to the yard, and issued provisions and clothing to the ships in port. Under the same regulations, the civilian Navy agent's job was broadened to include the sale of surplus and useless stores. As the shore establishment grew, the position of the naval storekeeper was set up to ease the load of the purser of the yard. Over the years, the Board of Navy Commissioners became a target for congressional criticism. Disclosures of waste and inefficiency led to its abolition, and a thorough revamping of the Navy structure. The Naval Reorganization Act of 1842 set up five naval bureaus. One of these was the Bureau of Provisions and Clothing. The name of purser was changed to paymaster in 1860, and 10 years later, these men won their own organizational title, the Pay Corps, which they kept until 1919, when the present title of Supply Corps was adopted. In the 1860s, the shore duties performed by civilian Navy agents and naval storekeepers were gradually taken over by the paymasters. With the introduction of the general stores system in 1887, the purchase, custody, and issue of material were consolidated under a pay corps officer. 5 years later, the name of the Bureau of Provisions and Clothing was changed to the Bureau of Supplies and Accounts, the present title of the Bureau, and one which reflects its increased responsibilities. All this time, the techniques of battle were changing too. The Civil War clash between the first ironclads, the Monitor and the Merrimack, spelled the end of wooden ships. Fighting in steel vessels marked the naval action in the Spanish-American War. Living conditions aboard ship were also changing with the times. Each man had received individual rations, which were pooled by several men in a small eating group or berth deck mess. About the time of the war with Spain, several ships experimented in feeding their crews together from a central area. The general mess idea proved so successful that the Navy abolished individual rations, and in 1901 adopted the new system. A year later, the first Navy cookbook was issued. In 1910, the afloat pay officer, now known as the ship's general storekeeper, was given custody of all supplies, except fuel, ammunition, and medical stores. A few years later, all paymasters, afloat or ashore, who were in charge of departments, received the title of supply officer, and their departments were called supply departments. Development of the Navy's standard stock catalog in 1914 marked a big advance in the science of supply. From the illustrations and standardized descriptions in these books, supply officers can be sure of getting exactly what is needed, though thousands of miles from a warehouse. By 1916, the supply structure was ready to shoulder the new burdens of our entry into World War I. There had been, however, no standardized course of training for new Supply Corps officers, even though the technical duties of the Corps had been mounting steadily. In 1934, the first comprehensive Supply Corps school was opened at the Navy Yard in Philadelphia, with courses in professional and administrative subjects, planning and business management. Today, the school is located at Athens, Georgia.